basically, financial help is trying to clarify the fact that too many people do not have the needed financial tools and resources in terms of knowledge, mentorship, platform, options, opportunities, and what they need to live the kind of life that they want to live. Why? Because the promise of our growing up years in terms of our academic, our journey into academic intelligence, going to school, coming out with good grades, getting a good job and all of that, that trajectory has not really worked. It's not really working. Interestingly, I tried to think back and I talked back to my older cousins because I'm the first child, and my older cousins to be like, man, Yuma, you're smart, you're intelligent, read very well, get Shell scholarship. Of course, when you're from the Niger Delta, those kind of conversations come up. Get Shell scholarship so that you can go to school 100% scholarship, and then you get out and get a good job. Now, the interesting thing is that when I think back to that, the guys that were telling me those kind of advice, that were giving me that kind of advice, I didn't like their life. Their lives were not attractive enough for me to say, okay, this is who I want to be when I grow up, when I graduate, when I'm done, when I'm building my career, this is the kind of life I want to live. But the law of academic the academic process ensures that people are processed into thinking in a certain kind of way. There's a certain kind of paradigm that's produced from getting people to be in a classroom or in a certain kind of situation for a number of years, encouraging them to be the best in their class, to be individualistic in their pursuits, to succeed in spite of. There are a lot of people, if we think back to when we were in school, there are a lot of people who got to be top of their classes, not because they were reading throughout the semester, but simply because they were very good at absorbing information. So 2-3 weeks to the exam, they would read and then just regurgitate when it's time for the exam. Afterwards, they've forgotten about it, but they came out tops. Life is selling us, is showing us how all of that equipping that we got in school is inadequate. Basically, one of the things I've got to discover in the last decade, in the last 10 years of my life, I'm going very much deeply into financial intelligence, into business, into trying to invest, not just getting into business, but in trying to investigate why we have the kind of outcomes we have in terms of why people, someone will get out of school, top of his class, first class, and starts working. And after 5-10 years, they are not achieving the dreams that they thought about in terms of, oh, I want to be this, I want to be that, I want to do this for my family, I want to do this for my community, I want to do this kind of, I want to be all of that. They seem to be living from paycheck to paycheck. There's a system that even when they are earning very high, they still have nothing to show for all their earnings. Why is it that we sit in today and look around and we see people who we think they are the lower bottom of the ladder, the vulcanizers? You have those who did not go to formal school, but they have a better financial handling with respect to how the outcome of their life is turning. I mean, you see people who are taxi drivers in Lagos that own houses, they own buildings that they rent out, right? You have people who are vulcanizers and they have massive apartments that they are renting out. Meanwhile, you have those who are managers, top executives in organizations, and they do not have all of these. They are earning very high, but they are still in debt. It's because there's two kinds of intelligence. There is what we call academic intelligence, and there is also what is called emotional intelligence. Unfortunately, there's so much fixation on academic intelligence to the detriment of emotional intelligence. That's the reason why, I mean, let me put it this way. You can succeed in life without academic intelligence, without going to school, but you cannot succeed in life without emotional intelligence. That is how massive it is. Because to just a bit of a dichotomy between both, in school, you are taught to be very individualistic, to do the best yourself so that you can come out first. As a matter of fact, I mean, it's so whack now, right, when I think about it. You're a boy and you come out second and a girl comes first. You get home and your parents are like, the girl, how will the girl beat you to first place? I'm like, how is that even anything? Why should that be a concern? But that system, even though they are saying that and they are doing it from the best intentions, what they are preaching is that they are telling that kid to be individualistic. That if you want to do something well, do it yourself. Put the best of yourself. Put your best foot forward. But guess what? In life, you cannot succeed by putting your best foot forward by yourself. In life, you succeed when you are able to connect with other people. You are able to create amazing results from having a team, from being part of a group, from being part of a system, from being part of a network, from being part of a team, from being part of a group. You succeed because you know how to work with other people. In school, you succeed because you are able to focus on yourself, how you can be the best of the best of the best version of yourself. That's a huge... So now, it's emotional intelligence that helps you sit within a group of people, and you are able to handle all their various, I mean, the differences among them. You're able to still harmonize, bring them together, harmonize them around one vision, and then drive them to succeed with that vision. It takes emotional intelligence. It does not take academic intelligence. We not help you achieve that. But guess what? That's what we're taught. That's what we're shown. Academic intelligence prepares you, right, to be someone who does not need to ask. I mean, one of the things I was thinking about, there's a book by Robert Kiyosaki. And Robert Kiyosaki says that the title of the book is Why Do A and B Students Work for D and E Students? For me, even without reading the book, one of the things that came to mind is when you are a D and E student in school, you have no choice but to ask for help. You go around everybody, please, when are you going to read? If you are following those who are going to read every time, even if you didn't follow them from the beginning of the semester, you start following them when it's getting close to exam, 1 month to the exam, you are going with them. When you are asking them, how can we solve this equation? Please help me. They say, oh, there's this other guy, he's very good in that. You go and look for him. Without knowing, you are already developing the skill of managing various people's egos, managing, asking for help. But guess what? People that are the best in their class, A and B, they don't know how to ask for help. The field is beneath them. But guess what? Emotional intelligence teaches us that you are not in this world by yourself, for yourself alone. That you must be able to organize yourself around other people to generate surplus results. If you want to generate surplus value in this life, if you are going to generate results that are beyond comprehension, you must have what we call in financial terms leverage, and that is the ability to organize with other people. Now, financial intelligence is one part of emotional intelligence. There's leadership intelligence. There is business intelligence. There's relationship. There's a lot of intelligence that you can break down, but they are all within emotional intelligence. One of the reason for financial help, for us having this conversation, is to say that we're looking at the times we are in. Things have changed, right? World has changed, whether we realize it or not. It's evident. But funny enough, before the world changed, having studied the whole landscape of financial, of the way we are handling our finances, I'm like, we have the wrong paradigms. We have the wrong thinking. We have the wrong upbringing. So haven't we brought up for 10, 20, 30 years, thinking a certain way? Some people 40, 50 years, thinking a certain way, organizing your finances in a certain way, organizing your the way you interact in a certain way. Just hearing, listening to me say this and saying, okay, this resonates with me, this guy is making sense, does not change anything, right? We're going to get to that where I deploy a plan, I show you a plan that we can use to build to where it is that we need to get to. But do you know that everything has changed? Even before COVID-19, the statistics showed that just 1 in 100 people that start working at 25, when they retire at 65, only 1 out of 100 is financially free. That means only 1 out of 100 is in a position where, whether they work or not, they have built systems in place so that they can take care of themselves. Only 1 in 100. But that's in America. What do you think the numbers will be in Nigeria? I can assure you that it's more disastrous. Apart from that, everything has changed. When the behavior of people change, it means that gaps are created in the market. For example, today people are not going out to the malls anymore. A neutral person, someone that is not thinking strategically, will say, oh, people are not going to the malls anymore. So, wow. Meanwhile, someone else sees a big business opportunity and says, you know what? There is a huge gap now in the space of delivering products, services, I mean, people getting to get their things, right? So let me go and invest in a logistics company, because it means that, you got to see, I like this. There's what a mentor to my mentor said, and it's very correct. He says when there is economic recession, so it's like people are losing money, there's no money. It doesn't, see, the money did not leave this earth and go into the space. What simply has happened is that money has moved from where you used to make it to a different direction. So where money used to be made is where you have a warehouse, you have a distribution system that required distributors, wholesalers, retail, and all of that. But hey, when the system change, when people's behaviors change, it means that money is no more flowing in that same distribution. Money has moved to logistics, where companies just say, you know what, we'll prepare our food or prepare our products, you order for whatever it wants, you want, and we deliver down to your doorstep. So wisdom is to how do I now position myself in the dynamics of commerce so that everything has changed. That's just one or two examples I'm trying to give on how everything has changed. The behavior of people have changed. So how money will be made, how we achieve our goals and our dreams, the systems and tools and all of our resources we deploy to ensure that we can get the best out of life has to change. Now, talking about finances, Robert Kiyosaki designed what we call the cash flow quadrant. And the quadrant basically tells us where every one of us is with respect to how we earn income. Now, majorly, there are two major ways we earn income. There are two major kinds of income, rather. There is active income and there is passive income. Now, active income is income that you earn as a result of your presence. So first, you need to be there. Secondly, your talents and your skills need to be there. Number three, you need to be there for a period of time. First, you need to show up in a particular location. So location is important. Number two, your personal talents and skills need to be there. Number three, you need to be there for a period of time. Now, that is for active income. For passive income is income that does not require your activity or your presence for a period of time in a particular location. To differentiate, for example, there are people that are dead today. They are no more alive, but they are still earning money. So what they are earning is what we call passive income, right? Now, Robert Kiyosaki says that you can break the way people earn into four different quadrants. The first quadrant is employee, and an employee is someone that has a job. Now, you work for the government, maybe in the public or the private sector. You have to-do lists. You need to show up in a particular office at a particular time for it to earn. If you do not show up, you do not earn. If you do not deploy your talents or your skills, you do not earn. Yourself, you do not earn. If you are not there for a period of time specified, you do not earn, right? So you have a job. That's an employee. That's where we got you earn. That this is where I earn my living. So really, really, what they are saying is that your time in that place is equal to money, this particular money. Let's say 300,000, 500,000, as the case may be that you're paid. The second quadrant is self-employed. Self-employed person is someone that says, okay, you know what? I want to set up my own thing. I'm good. I'm a good lawyer. I'm good with company, commercial law. I want to set up my own practice. I have one or two friends work together that are self-employed, or a dentist, or a consultant, a motivational speaker, someone that speaks, that goes around to speak and the rest of it. Or what can I think of now? There are loads of self-employed. So someone that says, you know, I've worked in a bank for a while. I'm very good with cooking. I want to go and set up my own small outfit there where I specialize in just Asun, for example. Or someone says, no, I've worked in the government for a while. I don't have time for myself, don't have time for my family. So I want to set up my boutique. Now, the trick here, where I think that a lot of people are stuck, is in thinking that moving from an E to an S gives them freedom. That is one of the greatest deceptions I have seen with respect to self-employed, right? Why? Because this really, really, fundamentally, there is no difference between an employee and self-employed. Because to me, an employee has a job. A self-employed gives themselves a job. All he just did was change the boss. You used to have the bosses at work. Now, in your own organization, in your own business, your business is now your boss. Because really, if you do not show up at a particular location and deploy your own skills and talents for a period of time, you do not earn. So how are you different from the employee? So to me, the employee and self-employed are really the same. The only thing is how they charge and they could. As a matter of fact, there are some employees that even earn more than people that set up businesses. So on the left side, you have the employees and the self-employed, and they trade their time for money, which is terrible. Because it means that they have no leverage. It means that if they do not show up in a particular location and deploy their skills and talents themselves for a period of time, they do not earn. So anything that affects their ability to be in a particular location, anything that affects their ability to spend a required number amount of time, and anything that affects their ability to deploy their talents in a particular space, it means that they do not earn. So active income. And guess what? 90% of the world, they are employees and self-employed. It is the reason why it's called the rat race, really. Because think about it, 90% of the world, they are there. And meanwhile, what they have access to is just about 10% of the world's resources. So it's really the rat race, because 90% of the world is trying to get the best of 10% of the resources of the world. Now, on the other side of the quadrant, you have passive income. And then you have business owner. Now, who's a business owner? A business owner is someone that operates a system. They create a system that has leverage, because employees have no leverage, because their time is equal to their money. Self-employed have no leverage. Their time is equal to their money. But the business owner starts the business understanding that I am doing this not because I just want to be best at what I'm doing. I may not be the best lawyer, but I need to be the biggest firm, right? For example, that's the difference between a self-employed lawyer and a business owner lawyer. A self-employed lawyer says, no, I came out top of my class. I am great at litigation. I squash my cases left, right, and center. I'm setting up my law firm. I'll be known in this city. Meanwhile, a businessman who is also a lawyer says, you know what? I don't care about being the best defense lawyer or the best whatever lawyer, right? What I want to do is I want to have the biggest law firm in West Africa that deals in litigation. Or I want to have the biggest law firm that deals in. So what do I do? Okay, you know what? I have friends. I have a network of friends. We've been in business relationship for a while. We knew ourselves in school and all of that. So we have three of us in Port Harcourt. There's three of us in Kaduna. There's three of us in Abuja. There's three of us in Warri. So you know what? Let's all of us come together and let's have a firm. It has one name. And then we can deploy all our resources. So with that, now a business owner that has that kind of law firm can have 20, 25, 30 cases going on across the nation. Guess what? They are pulling themselves together. One, we chase 1,000. But two, as the Bible says, we chase tens of thousands, right? But the self-employed, that self-employed guy is great at what he's doing. He's acing cases left, right, and center. But he can't take more than maybe 3 or 4 cases in a month. But the other guy is taking up to 20, 25, 30 cases in a month. And in a short while, it becomes... So a business owner thinks system and they leverage people to create more money. So they don't care about, oh, I want to put... It doesn't require them showing up by themselves in a particular location, deploying their own talents. It doesn't have to be their talents. You don't have to show up. The person that comes up with that system of that law firm, for example, I just described, it doesn't need to be there. He doesn't need to take the case. He might not even show up in the court for 5 years. Meanwhile, he's making a lot of money, going out there, creating relationships to bring in business into what he's doing. So business owners, they leverage people. It's what we call OPM, OPRO, or OPT, and OPT rather. OPM is other people's money. They take money from investors to invest in the business, to grow the business. Now, they work with OPM, or OPT rather, other people's time. That's employees. They use employees to work for themselves. They pay the employees who trade their time for money, why they create value, much more surplus value. And then other people's resources. They can take advantage, even that self-employed lawyer, maybe they have a lot of cases, they can decide to say, you know what, let's give some of our cases to this small firm, to these guys that are just 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 in the organization. Ladies and gentlemen, where we want to be, I believe, is on the right. But one of these quadrants, the first thing, if, for example, you're my friend and you come to Lagos, you say, oh, Yoma, hey, what's up? How are you doing? I'm in Lagos. I'm coming. I have an interview. I have an interview at the embassy, and you come to Lagos and you tell me I presently just got into Lagos, for example. I have an interview at the embassy. Please, how can I get to the Chinese embassy or the American embassy? When you call me, the first question I'm going to ask is, hey, nice to have you around, but where are you? So the first question here is, where are you? Now, the fourth quadrant says, fourth quadrant is investors. Investors, what they do is that they use money to create more money. So they invest their money, they leverage money to create more money for themselves. So of course, the investors invest in the business owners. The business owners employ the employees, and then self-employed offer services to the business owners and to the investors, right? Now, one of these quadrants define where you are. So you might be in one of them, you might be in both of them. They basically define where you are. Now, you're either on the right or you're on the left. You're either earning totally passive income or you're earning active income. I've been thinking about this, understanding the power of this, excuse me, been on this journey for a while. I've said that I wish that when I was in school, that every semester we had courses that were teaching us how to be financially free. The difference between passive income and active income, financial freedom, financial tools, and financial intelligence 101, even if that was the only course we did in school, because it is absolutely imperative. Because whether you like it or not, everybody on earth, every day, you spend money. Whether you make money or not, you spend money. Guess what? Not everybody is making money every day, but they are spending money every day. Babies that have never worked for once in their life, they are spending money. Madmen on the streets, they are spending money, whether they work for money or not. So everybody must spend money. The question is, how can you create a system for yourself so that you are producing more than you are spending? And you cannot produce more than you are spending just if you deploy only your efforts, your time, your talents in a particular location for a while. Now, the reason for this particular slide in front of us to let us know that the difference, there's a huge difference in the language, the facts, the history, of the left and the right. But basically, I'll just say that in conclusion, it is a function of paradigm. Now, being an employee is not saying that you are on a job, so that makes you an employee. Or you have your own business, that makes you a self-employed person. Or you have, you are in a big business where there's a lot of people, so you are, no. It is a function, it is more about paradigm. The paradigm of employee, the paradigm of the self-employed, the paradigm of the business owner. Because there are people I know today who are working in various organizations, that they have the mindset of the business owners. They are there for the meantime. Their job is more like a safety net for them. And they are leveraging the salaries they are making, the relationships they are building, because they are building to where they want to move to their own, or where they want to build assets for themselves so that they can be financially free. Ladies and gentlemen, where are you? Only 90% of the world, like I said, only 90% of the world are on the left. 10% of the world are on the right. Where would you rather be? Now, the language of the left is different from the language of the right. You have people on the left saying, you know, I work hard, I don't have any time, and I have debts, but the owner of this business, our company, he just comes by 11, he leaves by 2 o'clock every week. He's always traveling, South Africa today, Dubai tomorrow. He's just enjoying, we are the ones working. That is the mentality they think. They think that it's the work they are doing on their desk that produces all the income. They do not understand that there's a system that has been created around that organization that ensures that their work is done and there's more business that's coming in. Ladies and gentlemen, I am sure every one of us, if I ask you, where do you want to be? I'm sure everybody that's listening in here wants to be on the right. You want to be on the right. Ladies and gentlemen, there are a few things that determine that happens. Right? The purpose for this conversation, like I said, is to trigger something in us to get us to begin to think differently. Now, for you, if you are listening to me, there are three imperatives, right? Having come this far in this conversation, there are three imperatives for everyone that is listening to me right now. The first thing is that you are going to need to make more money. Of course, we are trying to make this session short, so I don't want to go in there. There's a lot of activities that we can do to prove to you why you need to make more money. Because basically, first, I always say that it is better to increase your capacity to earn rather than reduce your expenses. Because for many of us, it's not like we are splurging money around. It's just simply that we have not organized our finances. We've never used the tools of financial intelligence to organize how we earn, how we spend, budgeting and all of that. We've never done all of that. But basically, you need to earn more money. If you have a job right now, you need to create options for you to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 streams of income. If you have a business right now, why are you earning from just one business? The richest people in the world, they are not looking at earning from one company. Many of them have 20, 30 companies underneath the main company they started. Ladies and gentlemen, you need to make more money because you need to increase your capacity to earn more, and also you need to increase your capacity to be able to do more for yourself, and also you need to create surplus so that you can begin to save and put money aside towards your future, right? Because you cannot invest in opportunities, you cannot take advantage of systems if you don't have the capital. So first, you need to make more money. You can write this down, that from today, as soon as this session is over, I know that I need to make more money, number one. Number two, you need to have a retirement plan. And what do I mean by a retirement plan? You need to have a plan for when you're going to retire from working for money. I'm not saying when you retire from working. You can keep working till you are 90, 100, 120. If you love what you are doing, it's no more work. But guess what? Most people that are working today are working because of money. So you want to retire, you want to have a plan to say in the next 5 to 7 years, I, Yoma, I, whatever your name is, for me, I have my date of when I know that, okay, at this date, I stop working for money. I am working to create more value. I'm working doing what I love. I am working adding value to the world. I'm working doing, just enjoying myself, not because, I see, you cannot hope. You can't hear all I'm doing and say, you know what, I keep on going on my career. I hope I'm just believing God that something will happen and I'll become wealthy. It's not going to happen. I can announce to you, hope is not a strategy, right? You need to have a plan that you used to build. Number three thing, three imperatives from this conversation so far is that you need to begin to have a financial literacy journey. Now, financial help is saying, we call it HELP, H-E-L-P, Higher Education Learning Program. It's basically saying that we have a platform, we have an opportunity that you can come into and begin to start learning, start practicing, start doing. You learn by doing, you learn through coaching, mentorship. You see other people that are modeling the kind of life you want to live. You live in that space where every single day of your life, there is conversation and communication about this destination that you want to achieve. You know why? Because if you have grown in 20, 30, 40, 50 years of not doing the right thing, you are going to need serious training to reprogram your paradigm, to reprogram your character, your principles, to reprogram your practices, the way you are, you understand money, the way you handle risk, the way you think about money, the way you save. You need to, all of those things, you need to become a better knowledgeable person with respect to how you handle failure, how you handle loss, how you handle opportunities when they are standing in front of you and you might not be readily prepared for them. You need to get coaching. So if these three imperatives, you want to have them, our plan, our financial health plan, our opportunity, our platform is what I'm going to recommend to you in the next 10 minutes, in about 10 minutes rather. But first things first, you need to begin with a plan. What I'm going to share with you is our company, is our organization, but I call it a plan. Is a plan that takes from where you are to where you need to be. So where do you want to be? You need to define that. I say, first off, it only starts with a dream. What is your dream? What's the thing you, what, see, this might sound cliche, but this is not a cliche. If you find anybody doing something significant on earth, it's because there is something driving them. There is something they are seeing. It might not even make sense to you. For some people, is that, you know what, I just want Africa to have a better name. See, people that say they are very good at playing football. After 1-2 years of playing football, the next thing they start telling you that, you know what, I want to be the face of Africa in football. I want people to look at me and believe that there's something more in Africa. You see someone building a business, and the next thing they say, you know what, I want my I want my business to represent, you know, that a big business, a proper business can come from Africa to the rest of the world. Someone says, you know, my vision is that, you know, I want to create solid health facilities for my community that nobody will ever be sick and need to be raising funds, running health scatter. I want to create a world class. If I do that, I will find fulfillment in my life. Someone else might say, you know what? I want to help every child in my community go to school for free. From nursery to secondary, I will pay for the school fees every year for the rest of my life for kids. I will set up a foundation to that. Someone else says, you know what? I hate seeing kids hawk with trees around the street when they're supposed to be at school, right? So I want to ensure that I'm in a position to change that for people. Ladies and gentlemen, what is your dream? Because that dream is the only dependable fuel that will drive you to where you need to be with your life. You know why? Because life has its ups and downs. Business, as you're making money, there are times when you make money, there are times when you will not look good, there are times of like things like COVID-19 affected some people really badly. But when you keep on going back to the fact that, see, there are children depending on me, there are sick people depending on me, there is an Africa that needs me to be out there, there is a community that needs me to do well, to do all of these things. That's the fuel that drives it. That you say, no matter how hard things are, no matter how bad things have been, I will still keep going towards my dream. Ladies and gentlemen, you will not achieve your dream without being financially free. That's what the conclusion I've come to. And why do I say that? Because if you have to work for money for the rest of your life, if you have to just be living from paycheck to paycheck, which day ever are you going to ever achieve your dream? Because see, let's not beat around the bush. Every dream is going to need financing. Every dream is going to need money. Every dream is going to need to be heavily financed, right? And apart from the fact that that dream needs finance, you also, you are going to need finance for yourself, because you are not going to say, you know what, I really want to take care of kids and get them off the streets. Meanwhile, you have kids at home, you have not fed them, you've not clothed them, you've not put them through school. So guess what? A lot of people are stuck in their needs for the rest of their life rather than them ever chasing their dreams. They had dreams when they were young, yes. But by the time they started growing up, when older people started informing you, the things you were told, money does not grow on trees. Hey, come on, stop looking at those people. Must you go for that party? But, you know, they started restricting before you know. They conditioned a lot of us into the mode that we find ourselves today. And we are struggling every day to get out of it because there's a strong impression that it has been. As a matter of fact, I normally say that the operating system needs to be crashed and a new system needs to be installed. That process is not easy. And like I said, first, it begins with a dream. You want to clear what is that thing that was in my mind when I was 15, when I was 10, when I was 18, that was burning inside my heart. But by the time I experienced one failure, one heartbreak here, by the time I experienced all of that, I just realized that, you know what, let me just build my life, take step by step, slow and steady. And guess what? Many people spend 40 years doing slow and steady, and they look back and say, where did all the time go? How did I never ever scratch the surface of my dream? Ladies and gentlemen, before I share our opportunity, our company, our platform with you, I would like to let you know that you must start with a dream. One of the ways you can discover what your dream is, what is most passionate for you, is to think, if you, by the time you are 100 years old and you look back on your life and you're like, wow, I lived a full life. I lived a quality life. I lived a life of value. What is that thing that you would have done that will make you say that? From Stephen Covey in the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, says, begin with the end in mind. That if you are going to start this journey with us, if you are going to get into our business opportunity, if you are going to get into our company, our platform, our phenomenal platform with us, you will not succeed simply because our platform is amazing. You will succeed because you are driven by a dream that really takes this as a plan. Our platform is now just a map to help you get to where it is that you need to get to. So what is your dream? If you think back, another way you can figure out what you are most passionate about is think about today and say, you know what, if I am financially free today, financial freedom is simply when your passive income exceeds your living expenses. That is, you are in a position where what you earn without working takes care of every of your expenses. So think about it. If you build a system where you are earning, let's say, $1 million every month, passively, you don't need to work for it. And then your expenses every month is 500,000. Ladies and gentlemen, you are free. You are financially free for life. So if that, think about it, imagine that that is your situation right now today. What are you going to be doing with the rest of your life? That's on that way you can discover what really, really is a dream, a quality dream. And there are many dreams that can be attached to that big end, right? So what is your dream? What's your dream? Is it to achieve financial freedom that I've just talked about? Is it to see the world? You know, I asked my mom, I had a discussion like this some years back in Warri. My mom came for the session. I finished training and speaking. She was like, wow, I wish I knew all of this, because she was very retired. I wish I knew all of this, all those years I was working really hard, because I knew her. She had working so hard. She retired as a special grade principal. She was involved in, you know, teachers and cooperatives. She had cooperatives left, right, and center. She had shops in the market. She had shops in the town. She was always going to the farm. She was doing all just to ensure that she can give the best to her family. Guess what? Because she did not have the right intelligence, there was no leverage. All of that thing, all of what she was doing, depended on her. So because it depended on her, the best she could do is the best that she did, which was fine, and which is highly appreciated by all of us, as the kids and family. But when we had this session and I talked about how we need to leverage more than ourselves rather than just being on our own, she was like, wow. And I asked her, mommy, if you are financially free today, what will you be doing for the rest of your life? She just said, wow, I will travel. I mean, the way she said it, you could feel it. It was like, I will go and experience the world. I'm tired of just watching CNN and seeing this country. I want to go and see for myself. I want to experience it. I want to experience the local culture. I want to understand why people think the way they think. What's their history? She will travel the world. Maybe that is you. Or maybe you want to spend time with your loved ones. Something I love is just spending time with my son. I can spend the whole day with my son just playing and having fun and playing. But I have to work. I have to set things. But if I'm financially free, I can decide that day, you know what? I am not going anywhere. I'm spending this weekend 100% phone shots, everything with my family. So maybe spend time with your loved ones. Maybe spend time with your family. Maybe traveling my siblings and all of that. I'm like, maybe one day I should just go pack everybody and let's spend time together. I love things like that. But I can't remember when last that happened. It's been some years now because everyone needs to be financially free first before they can do that. Maybe that's you. Maybe you just want to be happy. Many of us grew up not having and not enjoying the things that those that are around us enjoy. Right? You can't go for the parties that you love because you don't have the clothes, you don't have the shoes, you won't look like other kids. And your parents are like, they don't want to embarrass themselves, so they don't want their children to be the child that is not well-dressed, that is not, you know, all of those things. And those things affect kids. And you grow up and you just feel like you don't belong. Then you just want to be happy. You just want to be able to do what you want to be able to look at and say, you know what? I want to take 500 people and just share with them my wealth of knowledge and do it for free. You don't need to pay. Or things like that. Or you want to impact lives and leave a legacy, right? Or you want to retire healthy, full of life. Because guess what? The statistics tell us that today, people are living longer. So health is a big industry. Why? Because people are living longer. And so because they are living longer, they want to live healthier. Now, what's your dream? I may not have mentioned your dream. I mean, I've gone around and maybe I didn't touch yours. Maybe some of the ones here apply to you and there's much more. What I want to share with you is that we have a platform that can help you achieve your dreams. In the next 10 minutes, I'm going to be sharing about this. And simply saying that our platform is Green Mondays. Green Mondays is a company based in Nigeria. We're here in Nigeria. I'm a distributor of the company. I'm not the owner of the company. So for those listening, so I don't say, oh, this is it. I'm a distributor and I'm passionate about the goal and vision because this is a platform that is helping me in the interim doing what I want to do. And for the long term, I can see how much it will help me not only earn extra income, those three imperatives I told you, earn extra income, you have it here, right? Number two, get the right education, mentorship, coaching, training, and all of that. We have too much of that here. In the last 6 months, I can say that maybe I should be awarded 2 or 3 MBA certificates. The kind of trainings that I've gotten, it is amazing. The changes I have seen, I've done a lot of trainings over the years. I mean, receiving trainings, not training, and it's been explosive. The number three imperative I talked about earlier, right? It has almost escaped me now. But yes, I say you need to begin a coaching journey to financial freedom, and then yes, passive income. Now, what is this platform, Green Monday? What's the mission of Green Monday? First, to inspire. Secondly, to connect. And third, to do what? To empower you to achieve your dreams. Now, Green Monday is a network marketing company from Nigeria, positioning globally. And it is amazing what it is that we're doing because we have world-class management. Products are amazing. I'm going to talk about products in the next couple of 2-3 minutes. The system is unbelievable. Now, I like to tell people at this point to share that what network marketing really is. Too many people do not understand what network marketing is. But network marketing is simply a system of distribution. Now, if you know about factors of production are those things you can leverage really to build wealth. Things like inventions, things like land, labor, you know, those kind of things, entrepreneurship that we talk. See, in this day and age, distribution is a massive industry. Because think about it. Facebook, what are they doing? Distribution. Zoom, we are on Zoom right now. What are they doing? Distribution. Amazon, what are they doing? Distribution. So it's basically saying that we are creating a platform that people can leverage on to get their services or their products out to other people. That in this day and age today, when people want to sit at home, go to church at home, go to school at home, collect friends at home, do everything from home by choice or by force because of COVID-19, network marketing is such a fantastic system of distribution. Why? Because it says that rather than manufacture a product in the warehouse, it's now selling warehouse. From warehouse, you have regional distributors. From regional distributors, you have distributors. And then from distributors, you have wholesalers. From wholesalers, you have retailers. And then it goes to final consumer. And for the consumer to go to the mall, or to the corner shop, or wherever supermarket to get that product, the manufacturer invests hundreds of billions of naira in advertising on TV, on Big Brother, on billboards, everywhere radio. You see the adverts going on and on and on so that you and I can be familiar with the product. And guess what? when we go out, we can purchase the product. That's the purpose for that, right? Network marketing says rather than go through the entire system, the manufacturer takes the product directly to the consumer and gives the consumer an opportunity to be what? A distributor. Very simple. So the money that would have gone into advertising, into marketing, into all of that, the money that would got, if you can, someone says they can't get, if you can't get the order, I think you can just refresh because I think everybody can hear me. If it's your internet. So the money that should have gone into advertisement, rather than going into advertisements and all of that, margins for distributor, wholesaler, blah, 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 and the rest of it, is distributed downstream, even while we leverage. Now, how does network marketing work? Very simple. The Green Monday has a phenomenal product called the RIDA Herbal Bitters, right? We have the RIDA range of products, but this is the flagship product. So the product was brought to me to say, okay, Yuma, hey, look at our division of the company. We're distributing this using network marketing model. Use our products. You need it. Today, everybody wants to live healthy. And people are looking for better alternatives. Even the West, they are looking for alternative medicine because a lot of the orthodox medicine that was synthesized is not working. Or it's not working as well as they want. And also, why it is working is also depositing toxins in the body that is giving a secondary issue and tertiary problems also. So those things are there. And then I used the product, I gave it to my mom, gave it to her friends, and they're like, wow, this is amazing. We feel strong. It's helped in diabetes, helped in high blood pressure, helped in high sugar level, hormonal imbalance, those kind of things. I mean, testimonies coming in. What did I need to do if I wanted to do the network? All I need to do is share with my friends, right? To say, hey guys, see what's going on here. I don't know about your dreams, but I'm seeing that this is a phenomenal platform that I can use to achieve my dreams. And I have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of my friends come on board and say, you know what? Hey, we get trained. We see people that are doing amazing stuff. We get training and mentorship and leadership from them. We learn what they've learned. And then my friends do what? They tell their own friends. Go tell their own friends. Now, as that keeps on going, as these people are using the product, whether they don't even need to sell the product, just purchasing products to use for themselves. From the use of the product, I am earning amazing income every month. Now, let me make this very clear. During the lockdown, I have a travel business. Not doing badly, by the grace of God. I also have a consultancy business. I train people, I train organizations. During the lockdown, I've not earned a dime, really. When I was looking at my company statements, I've not earned a dime for travel. No money coming in, except monies that were meant to come in based on previous business we had done before the lockdown. And it's amazing that 6, 7 months, no money coming in. And then my consultancy, nobody's paying for trainings at this time. You go only do free trainings, pending when people start earning, and then they can call you to say, you know what, let's do this with you. But guess what? My network marketing business was growing from month to month to month. As a matter of fact, it grew faster during the lockdown than before the lockdown. Why? Because the system that does not require this traditional system of distribution is from me to my friend, to my neighbor, to their in-laws, to their friends. And through that, our range of products were going round and round the world. We have the RIDA Herbal Bitters, fantastic product because it's great on oxidative stress. Oxidative stress is regarded as the main cause of most of the illnesses on earth. Right? Things like high blood pressure, sugar imbalances, and hormonal imbalances, high sugar level, and the rest of it. Why? Because oxidative stress is simply a situation where the toxins that have come into the body due to bad lifestyle, maybe alcohol, how we're living, or stress, or just work, stressing ourselves every day. The toxins that are built up have overpowered or weakened the ability of our antibodies. And because of that, foreign bodies can get to the body and then cause one issue or the other, right? That is how oxidative stress results in high blood pressure, results in diabetes, results in high sugar content, results in stress, results in fever and all of that. So RIDA Herbal Bitters deals at the cellular level. It's an antioxidant, fantastic, phenomenal antioxidant, and it is not even bitter. So it is amazing. This product has gone around about 12, 15 countries of the world. Yesterday, I was listening to testimonies. I was on a Zoom call listening to testimonies from Qatar, from Philippines, from Indians that are using Lebanese. It is amazing that this product is from Nigeria, made with herbs and going around the world. We have RIDA Balm, we have RIDA Disinfectant, we have RIDA Hand Sanitizer, Hand Wash, we have the Body Butter and all of that. That's on the personal hygiene and the health space. For the personal care space, we have our products coming on for our hair creams and all of that, all made from herbal products. This is fantastic. It's coming from Nigeria. For me, I have my own personal dream, but I am passionate about this because this is also something we're doing that portrays us as, you know what, Nigerians can do this. Africans can do this. We are already in Canada. We have testimonies from Canada, from the US. It is exciting. Now, network marketing makes this happen because while you're doing this, you are earning fantastic income, right? So I'm earning from the activity I'm doing every day, but I'm also earning from the activity of my team. I've grown a team of people from duplication and multiplication of ourselves, training ourselves, getting better at strategic thinking, getting better at understanding business systems, how to work this. And we leverage our network to use the product, enjoy this range of products, over 11 right now. And by the time our personal care products, we can have up to 20 and much more than that in our range of products. As we're using this product, as everyone is using the product and maybe selling a little to their friends and family, we're earning amazing income. We have 13 ways to earn. See, the only reason I like saying is that the only reason why over the last 5 to 10 years, you have not earned 10 billion naira or 20 billion is simply because you have not used leverage. You have tried to earn money by yourself. But network marketing says, rather than earn 100% of my own effort, I'd rather earn 1% of 100 people's efforts, right? That's what I'm doing. It doesn't stop me from running other businesses. This can be, I know I tell people that I recognize, I even celebrate people that do this at a plan B or a plan C or a plan D, because it tells me that you are serious with what you are doing and you understand that this is an outlet to build fantastic income for you. And like I said, with respect to learning financial intelligence, with respect to learning business intelligence, with respect to learning to getting equipped with all of the tools that you need to get to where you need to get to in your life. As a matter of fact, I can't tell you how much these tools I've learned from network marketing has helped me to build my consultancy, has helped me to build my travel business. Because it's what I've learned from team building, leadership, communication, sales, marketing, mentoring, building teams, leadership. It is what I've learned from all of those that has helped me. And I learned them from network marketing. It's amazing. You know why? Because network marketing is true entrepreneurship. It's not about selling. I tell people that one of the number one skill you need in network marketing is storytelling, the ability to share your story with somebody else. Number two skill you need is the ability to almost be like, let me put it nicely, is to be teachable. To be able to just look and they say, do this. And you struggle with it based on what you know. And you're like, no, but don't you think I should do it this way? They're like, do it. And you're like, no, is it going to work? Because it might look too simple. The process to succeed might look too simple. That you'll be fighting it. Why? It's simply because of the paradigm that we grew up with. So ladies and gentlemen, this is a phenomenal opportunity. I want to encourage you. Talk to the person that invited you, that gave you the link. For those who are here, if you came late, sorry, we'll try to start on time. It's supposed to be 1 hour, 12 to 1. So we're going to do that. We'll have 3 minutes more. Talk to the person that invited you. Let them share the products with you, the effects of the products. We have loads of products, what they do, amazing stuff. You can check them and you can let you know. You can also get testimonies. Look at testimonies of people from different parts of the world doing amazing stuff. Also, these are the options to get in, right? We have 5 options. The highest is 750, the lowest is 40,000. I always tell people, get in with the most you can, because the best place to be is 750,000. But the beautiful thing about it is that regardless of whichever option you come in with, what you pay for, you get more products than you pay from. So from day one, even without inviting any friend, even without talking to any, even before starting to build your team, you already are in profit. And then the next step is, what do I need to do? I tell people, always do that. That's one of the best things. Like I said, number one, skill, storytelling. Number two, being teachable. So when you come in, the next question is, what do I do next? When you do that, you go back to your upline. What's the next thing I should do? What's the next thing I should do? Anybody that does that, I have seen how fast they grow in the system, because there is a system and systems are deployed by systems. It's not try this today, try that tomorrow, try this. No, that's the beautiful thing about an organized system like network marketing, because there is a process, there's a training, there's a system, there's all of that put in place to ensure that you can get from where you are to where you need to be. So what's your dream? What's your goal? What do you want to achieve? And are you passionate about it, or are you passionate enough about it, or you are just paying lip service to your dreams? I hope you are not among those that pay lip service to your dreams. I hope you see, people are not poor, P-O-O-R, because they do not have money in their pockets. People are not poor, are not business owners because they have a lot of money in their pocket. People are not self-employed because they have little money in their pocket. And it's not about the amount of money. It's about opportunities. People are poor, P-O-O-R, because they pass over opportunities repeatedly. Do not allow this pass you by. Please make a decision on this. This is one of the most exciting teams, exciting opportunities, exciting platforms to ever be a part of. I am grateful for all of my team leaders. I'm grateful for everybody that has mentored me. I'm grateful for the privilege of mentoring a lot of people, of showing people what I have learned. I can't wait to show you today. So please talk to the person that invited you. Let's get this started and let's get this going on. By 6 o'clock again, we'll have another session. By 9 p.m., we'll have another session. We have room for a couple more, so you can share with your friends to say, you know what, I listened to something, or you can come listen to it again. I mean, I have some people that have listened 2, 3, 4, 5 times, and they're like, you know what, I'll get better every time I hear something different. Thank you very much, and you have a good day.